Wrong password? Let's try again. Oh no! I've been hacked?
Functionals are everywhere, most of the time we're unaware, but horses know we're leaking all the time. When looking in the fridge, when coughing does the bidding bridge, your sardinals for fun and for the prize, cause sardinals are with us all the time.
And then Manuel enters the pin and then he sees wrong pin.
A pin entry to protect your online account? What year is it? I mean, that's so unrealistic.
But a pin entry is a great example to start explaining side channels and software to our audience.
Daniel? How would I recover a lost password?
Is there a password recovery option?
I don't exactly have access to the email address anymore. So PIN as authentication is one thing, but a mail account that expired?
We wrote a paper about that where we show that we can recover access to accounts.
Again with the self-promotion here, Daniel. What are you doing?
So maybe that's how the attacker also got access, your mail account that you don't have access to anymore.
Hi guys, what's happened?
Manuel got hacked or something.
Really? Hacked? So how long was your password?
Was it even a password?
Can I tell that? Isn't that really insecure?
I mean, if you tell me, we might be able to brute force it.
Yes, just tell me your password and I will recover your password. Of course. But yeah, you might be able to crack it, yes, of course.
Yeah. For instance, if you just have one digit and there it says it's like a pin, so it just assume only numbers, then we
that's
just
true,
have
yeah.
like 10 combinations, right?
Yeah.
For two digits, we would have 100 and so on.
Yeah, it's four digits. How many possibilities do we have to try there?
10,000. 10,000 combination.
You can imagine a brute force attack like someone guessing the pin and the computer just says yes or no. How many pins does a person have to guess until they found the right pin? Let's start with a very simple example. A secret one-digit pin. It can be any number from 0 to 9. If I start guessing, in the worst case, I might need 10 attempts to get the right number. Now let's look at a two-digit pin. If you look at it like a number, you see that now all numbers from 0 to 99 are possible. That means, in the worst case, I might need 100 attempts to guess the secret pin. For a three-digit pin, 0 to 999 are possible, so I might need 1000 attempts to guess the correct secret pin. So you can see that for each additional digit, it is 10 times more possible pins and therefore 10 times more attempts in the worst case. More elegantly, you can write this down as a mathematical expression. 10 to the power of n, where n is the length of the password or pin. In Manuel's case, it's a four-digit pin, so the number of attempts in the worst case is 10 to the power of 4, which is 10,000.
This isn't going to work, you know? See, it says 70 more attempts left. That's a bit less than 10,000.
70 attempts? Wouldn't something like 3 attempts be more realistic?
Well, absolutely, but we need a good scenario here for our side channel. With your 4-digit PIN, there are only 10,000 possibilities, so we will get your password or your PIN back.
And that means I have to run this for 100 days and then maybe I get my access back, really?
Yeah, in the worst case, so if the PIN is very small, you might find it earlier.
No, like a very low number, like 1,
yes,
2, 3.
Yes, yes,
okay. Oh, 1, 2, 3, 4.
Yeah.
4 minutes, right.
I think we should try to think like the attackers. How did they get in? And maybe we can get access through the same way.
Okay.
For instance, was there a database leak or something? Maybe, Lucas, can you check haveibeenpwned.com?
Haveibeenpwned.com is a website run by Troy Hunt, and he collected tons of database leaks, and you can check whether your account and the corresponding password has been leaked in one of those database leaks.
There I have already checked. I haven't been there.
Okay.
So, I don't think that's how they got it.
So no credentials leaked. Okay, that's already great.
Yeah. So I actually had an idea.
Hmm?
We learned about side channels and stuff recently, right?
Yeah.
And so I thought maybe there is one, and I recorded a bunch of traces yesterday. So give me a sec, like runtime and stuff.
Yeah. Maybe.
Let's see.
Yeah.
Let's check out what Lucas has.
Okay, so that's the package size. Doesn't look too 20
how
packets.
Many, how many packets? 20 packets, yeah. Okay. And all exactly the same package size. Okay, so there's no side channel in the size of the packet.
Let's look at latency. Nice.
Oh, that's what... Is this sorted by anything? What types of packets did you send?
Yeah, so I just sent like a 1,000-something, 2,000-something, 3, 4...
Ah, so it's the same 20 packets?
Yeah, it's the same as before.
Okay.
So it looks like there's something there.
Wait, right? So this is the pin that started with 4-something, and this is also a pin that started with 4-something.
Yeah, I think we found something.
It looks like a side channel. But if that works, then maybe we can mount an end-to-end attack here. And if we got the first digit that way, and they checked the other digits in the same way, then we should be able to recover the entire pin in fewer tries.
Wait, so what? Do we have a digit now?
Yes, the first digit is a 4.
So you're thinking it's slower if it's correct?
A simple but insecure way of implementing a pin entry is to check the entered pin by the user digit by digit against the pin that was stored on the server. As soon as a digit is not the same as in a secret stored pin, we abort the comparison and tell the user that the pin was not correct. This results in a different timing behavior, where more correct digits means that the computation time will be longer.
Okay,
but that means we still have... We still need 1,000 more tries, which means we still need 10 full days.
Maybe not. If we use the same side channel again for the next digit, we get fewer tries. Then we only need 10 tries, I think, for the next level, for the next digit.
And it's 10 per digit.
And then we only need 40 tries. Well, only 30, because...
We already know one.
Yes.
Let me try that.
So, Manuel, how many tries do you have left?
Yeah, it should be around 50 with the 20 that...
So, I think I have something.
Okay.
So, I hacked something together. You ready for your pin?
Wait a second. We have 31 tries left.
I'm using exactly 30 tries.
And it's gonna work.
I think so.
All right.
All right. Let's see.
Okay.
So we have 4.
4, 9.
9. 5. 4, 9, 5, 8.
Okay.
Okay, let me reload this here. Okay. Manuel, it says 1 attempt left. Can you type in the pin?
Yes, I will do that. 4, 9, 5, 8. It's loading.
It works.
Oh, yes.
All right.
Okay, nice. You're in.
Thanks. I think I probably just forgot that I changed the pin. Oopsie.
What?
Yeah, I think I changed it a few weeks back and I forgot.
And you let us hack into this system?
What did I do all that for?
But
nice, I guess. Sorry. Thanks, though. Thanks so much. Thank you, guys.
But Manuel, change your mail address in that account. If you need the password recovery next time, you can use it.
That makes sense. Thank you. Thank you. I will.
Yeah.
And that's it? Shouldn't we also teach the people how to make things more secure instead of just exploiting them?
Oh yeah, I was just about to explain that in the next scene. Yeah, and then Lucas had the entire pin recovered with the timing side channel. And then Manuel is like, oh no, I just changed the password recently. And yeah, and
wow.
Yeah, so we hacked into Manuel's account, although he did not get hacked, but just forgot his pin.
But that sounds like a security vulnerability. Did you disclose it to the developers?
Oh, of course. Of course. We contacted the administrator of the website, and we didn't get any response so far.
Okay. Is the source in the code open source? Did you check?
I don't know. So maybe you can search whether it's online.
Let me look. Yeah, it's online.
Oh, yeah.
And it's really easy. I checked out the code and...
Can I have a look?
Yeah. When you check out the code, here's where it checks the pin. And it just iterates over the four digits and compares the two digits at the correct position. And if it's wrong, the first time it gets wrong, it just returns, and otherwise it continues. So you have a timing difference there.
But can't we just not return in the if? Otherwise set a variable or something like that?
Yeah, set a boolean.
I'm trying it out right now, so I'm almost have it.
Ah, yeah.
So let's check.
So you have a boolean, you set it to true.
Yeah, so now I just check, I set the boolean, I set it to true.
If it's wrong, okay.
Yeah, and otherwise I just return that. So let's check it out. So
let's see whether that's constant time. I mean, that it sounds good.
It should be.
It should always run the same thing.
So here we have the unpatched one. So you can clearly see here for the three, it's a lot less time that's needed for the four.
Okay, so wait a second. So that's a latency in milliseconds? Wow, that's a lot of difference. Or is it cycles?
It's milliseconds.
Okay.
So we can clearly see the difference. So let's try the patch one now.
That's a huge difference.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It should be.
You see? Here it looks a lot nicer, right? It looks the same.
Well, it's still, I'm not sure whether it's just from my angle here, but can you zoom in there? It still looks a bit weird. So zooming in on that. Oh, no.
Oh, the leakage is still there.
Yeah.
Still a
it's
leakage.
It's smaller, but it's there.
So this is still not side channel resistant. Maybe we have to come up with something better. What could we do? So maybe the boolean and this branch. Ah, yes, of course. In the one case, it sets the boolean to true.
Mm-hmm.
And in the other case, it doesn't do anything.
Yes. That's the problem, of course.
So can you change that? Can you introduce a second branch?
So now we have that, more or less what you said. We have a branch, and in the else path, we also do something, so we should have the same amount of operations that happen. So the time difference shouldn't be that, or there shouldn't be any time difference.
Okay, let me understand that. So in the one case, you set the wrong value, so a value to true, the variable wrong, that tells us that the pin was wrong.
Yes.
And in the other case, you set a dummy to whatever value.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And so now the program is executing the same instructions.
The same operations, yes. Yeah.
So now when we execute that again.
Oh, this looks a lot better.
It looks nice, right? But
Is it really? Can you also zoom in again? Not that we overlook something there.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, there's still leakage.
But why?
In theory, that's a great strategy. But this always the same is more difficult than it actually sounds. Right, so this holds for real life as for computers. Doing the same thing twice in exactly the same manner is a hard job.
This could be some microarchitecture effect, maybe.
Caches?
Maybe caches? Branch prediction?
You haven't even explained caches, the TLB, branch prediction. How should the audience understand how this works?
We can go slow here, right? They don't need to understand any of these terms yet, but it helps if they heard them. For now, they only need to know what the difference is in terms of instruction sequences. If there are differences, then this will be vulnerable to side channels. Or differences in what the processor does in other ways, then it will introduce a side channel.
Are there any difference in the memory locations accessed or the order in which they are accessed?
That's also side channels, yes. But what about register values? That's usually fine.
Yes, so register values usually don't have a side channel.
I think the only option we have is to make this really side channel secure is we need to make sure that everything always executes the same way. So the program logic must not distinguish between the input based on the secret in any form.
So you mean using something like math?
Yeah, so maybe just count up for the correct and wrong digits.
But without an if?
I mean, you could use the XOR operation. Then it's just, if they are the same, you get zero as a result.
And then we sum up all results of the XOR instruction, and if it's zero, the bin is correct, because if at least one digit was wrong, it's not zero.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So maybe you should try that.
This could work.
Yeah, can you maybe implement that? It should be less code than before.
Yeah.
Oh, you missed a semicolon there.
Ah, yeah. Typical programming mistake.
Yeah.
Okay, so now we do that exactly what we said. We just XOR the input with the secret pin, and in the end, we check whether the value is zero or not.
So with this XOR, how does this operation work then? So if it's, let's say we XOR 0 and 0, what's the result then?
Zero.
Zero.
And if we XOR 1 and 0?
1.
And if we XOR 0 and 1?
1.
1.
And if we XOR 1 and 1?
0.
So it's exactly 1 if they are different and 0 otherwise.
So maybe we just try. So we have the patch. Let's execute it and we can see here. We have the result.
Okay, zoom in again.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, maybe it's still leaking. Yeah. We don't know. Okay. Okay, yeah, looks good so far.
Enhance a bit more.
Let's just look at this
far. Okay, so this is really, really stable. This is really the same. Awesome.
Perfect.
I think we did it.
Yes. Maybe you can push this as a pull request to the repository.
Working on it now.
Very nice. So that means that the only thing we can do to mitigate these side channel attacks is to write code that always does exactly the exact same instructions in the same location, accessing the same memory locations. There should be no difference that depends on any secret. And that's the only way how we can make this code secure.
Ha! Nice! My patch just got merged.
The one for the pin entry?
Yeah.
Cool.
Oh god, no! Not again!